This is Pamela Kuhn, and the curtain is up on Center Stage, the show about the arts and the artists behind their work. It seems appropriate to me today that I begin this show with a quote by Rainer Maria Rilke. He says, "I live my life in widening circles that reach out across the world." Well, I speak often on Center Stage about those individuals who are naturally born to be adventurers. And then there are those who are the searchers, perhaps not finding their bounty, but living the dream of discovery. And then there are those who simply know what they want from a young age, a calm sense of knowing which gives way to determination. Well, my guest today is that person. From a young age, he knew the brass ring that he envisioned. It was that of combining science and sound, of dreaming about classical music and being in the concert hall, but at the same time, building the electronics that would define and enhance the musical performance. And so it was that a young Steven Epstein dreamt of walking in the shoes of record producer Tom Frost, to be included on the covers of LPs as engineer and producer. And now, several decades into his superstar career, music producer Steven Epstein has realized success with 18 Grammy wins and 35 nominations. He has won the Grammy for Classical Producer of the Year 7 times. But that is not enough for this man who dreamed large and found his slipstream of performance. For he has also traversed into musical theater, crossover, soundtracks, and the spoken word for children. He has worked with such a wide variety of performers at the top of their game that it is dizzying. Legendary work with cellist Yo-Yo Ma, Wynton Marsalis, Emmanuel Ax, Placido Domingo, Isaac Stern, Bobby McFerrin, that is just a small taster of his accolades. The orchestras that he has worked with are equally impressive, from Vienna to Berlin, the New York Philharmonic, Chicago, Cleveland, the Concertgebouw. The list goes on and on. And then, of course, there is the Silk Road Project and Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. How do you define legend? The name is Steven Epstein. And guess what? He's a really nice guy. So it gives me great pleasure to welcome Steve to Center Stage. This is a moment in time I have waited for. Steve, we first met over 35 years ago, and it is brilliant to be reunited for this interview. And tell me, here is a question to start this off. Since we first met, how would you define your life?
That was such a beautiful intro, Pam, that I don't know if I have anything else to say.
Okay, we can go now.
No, it's great to reconnect with you, and I've been so impressed by what you've been doing over the years.
Thank you.
So this is a wonderful mutual admiration society we have here. The question, I think just being incredibly busy, and you know, the few moments that I have, I enjoy looking back to see what I've done, the great artists that I've been fortunate enough to work with. And then I go way back to when I was first introduced to classical music at the age of 2. And it's been just a love affair with classical music since then, as well as my interest in technical, as you mentioned, in building electronic kits and technique of recording, microphones, that kind of a thing. So no complaints.
No complaints at all. Do you know, I believe that you were handed that classical recording. It was an LP when you were 2 years old. I find that so extraordinary. But, you know, you connected with that, didn't you? Wasn't it a Mozart piano concerto, actually?
You've really done your research. I'm very impressed, but not surprised. It was Mozart's 21st piano concerto with Robert Casadesus, the pianist, and it was conducted the New York Philharmonic Society back then. This is 1949, I believe. The recording was made, I think, in 1949. And the conductor was Charles Munch. And it was on a 10-inch, not a 12-inch, but a 10-inch Columbia Masterworks LP. I still have it. It's all scratched up from listening to it over and over, you know, at that age. And amazingly enough, my very first recording in 1974, in July of 1974, was a piano recording of Robert Casadesus's wife, Gabby Casadesus, playing his music. He was a composer as well. And it was recorded at the famous 30th Street Studios of Columbia Records. And I produced that, and it was like coming full circle.
It was.
Right? Isn't that amazing? And I remember showing her, bringing the record, the album to show her, and she signed it, you know. So it was, and that recording was made, the original recording was made also at 30th Street. So it was meant to be.
Steven, that is the most amazing story. You're certainly born under the right star.
No question. Yeah, no question.
Coming full circle is a huge theme on my show, and I love it when we live those moments, you know. How special for you. And I remember when you and I met some 30-some years ago. It seems like yesterday. You told me with delight about when you were young building a Heath kit.
That's right. I just love building electronic kits. Unfortunately, Heath kit, they went out of business, and now they're sort of back in business because everything is put on chips now, on integrated circuits. Back then, you had individual resistors and capacitors, circuit boards that you'd be able to solder. And it was a certain purity in getting the kit, putting it on the table, opening up these parts, and looking at the instructions and just realizing you're going to be putting something together that hopefully is going to work. And when you switch it on, and that is one of the most satisfying things after you build your particular kit. So I mostly built amateur radio equipment. They have an amateur radio license. And that's now collecting dust, because we're talking 1978, I think, is when I got my ham license and when I built that transceiver. But that interest in electronics transcended to my interest in what I do, which is microphone technique. I mean, most producers, classical producers, pretty much are responsible for the musical content of a recording, making sure all the notes are covered during a recording session, and sticking pretty much to the musical aspect of recording, and leaving the engineer or the tone meister to do the technical work, the microphone positioning, how many microphones. But having learned my craft at Columbia Records, where the producers had a good deal of interest and were able to work in the capacity of microphone placement and technical things, that's sort of how I grew up in the business at Columbia Records as a kid. I was 22 years old, right out of college, when I started working at Columbia Masterworks. And my mentor was Andy Kasdan, who was one of the great producers ever, I think. And he took me under his wing, and working with engineers like Buddy Graham, I was, you know, I couldn't have been luckier. I was the youngest person there. Now I'm, well, after retiring, I was one of the oldest people. So most of the engineers that I had started working with were gone at that point. And I take perhaps more of an interest as a producer in the technical end of recording as well.
Okay. Are you known in that fashion for a certain sound that you can create? Is there a Steven Epstein sound that you're recognized for?
Well, I like to think so. Probably not that kind of acknowledgement by the listening public, let's put it that way, except hopefully that my records are enjoyed and on both musical and technical levels. But when I started working in 1973, the classical recording was mostly done with multiple microphones, multiple tracks, 30 or 35 microphones to record an orchestra, and eventually, over the years, I started to prune that down, where I've done many recordings. I've done the complete Sibelius symphony cycle in Pittsburgh with Lauren Mizell with only two microphones.
Wow.
And you can only do that with a great orchestra, with great acoustics, and also having time during rehearsal to set up your microphones and listen. The AF of M would not allow that years ago. You were not allowed to listen at a rehearsal and set up your mics. Now you're not allowed to record, but you're allowed to listen and hone and refine your mic technique. So there's a certain purity with regard to recording with fewer microphones than many microphones. And you can't do that, as I say, all the time, unless you have the greatest ensembles or whatever. But I think if there's any stamp of the sound that I get, it's basically minimal microphones and whatever that brings forth in, you know, over the loudspeakers.
So less is more, perhaps.
It's exactly correct. Yes, I believe so.
Go back just a little bit to speak about Tom Frost. I mean, as a child, you admired him, and I feel I read that you eventually were interviewing with him for your first job at Columbia. Another circle complete.
Well, yeah. I as a teenager, I would collect pictures from stereo magazines and create a scrapbook with pictures of recording. Sorry, there goes the phone. With pictures of the recording sessions. Let me just do that.
No, well, that's probably Yo-Yo Ma on the telephone, ready to engage.
No, that's okay. I'll call back. No problem. it's more like a scam call, so that's probably. what was I saying? Oh yes, as a teenager, I collected pictures and put a scrapbook of recording sessions, microphone techniques, and that kind of a thing. And of course, Tom Frost's name always came up in these situations. And he was the co-director of Columbia Masterworks at the time. He and Tom Shepard, another wonderful producer, were both directing Columbia Masterworks. And I thought, well, I was in high school at this point, and I thought, well, let me write to him. I would love to attend a recording session. I would love to see how it's done. And he wrote a lovely letter back to me, telling me what's required. Back then, there were no colleges that had recording programs, sound technology programs. I teach at McGill University. I'm an adjunct professor there. They have one of the best, if not the best, sound technology program in existence. It's incredible.
Interesting.
How critical that course is. But in any event, there are other colleges as well that offer these kinds of courses. But back in 1968, there were only communications type courses and that kind of a thing. So he told me what I should prepare if I wanted to be a producer or an engineer, classical. And then I worked on having an interview with him and with Tom Shepard and at a different time. But I met Tom Frost out of high school, or I was still in high school. And he was the nicest, most disarming individual that I could have met for someone in his position.
Wow.
And it was just terrific. And he said to me as well, as he had written in the letter, what I should do in my college, once I get to college to major in music. And he said, let me know when you graduate and let's see, you know, let's see what the story is. So I, right after 4 years later, I graduated college after having majored in music. And he went to see me. I had an interview with him again, and then with Tom Shepard and with some other people. And it was June of 1973, just following my graduation at Hofstra University. And they put in a call saying that they're interested in hiring me. And I went through the whole summer. It was either me or this other fellow who was actually more qualified at the time, and suffering all the way through the summer, making phone calls. Well, what's going on here? And I finally was hired with this other fellow and started on September 4th, in fact, in 1973. So those interviews definitely paid off, and it was just a dream come true.
Your determination paid off, Steven Epstein.
I think so,
you know,
sure.
This is a message to all of us that our dreams can come true. We just need to know what our dreams are and see that fully realized. Wow.
No question.
Impressive. Mm-hmm. You know, you speak about that there were no recording programs, in other words, to educate you in the art. And now you're at McGill. You speak so fondly of this program. How gratifying is it to you now to be able to give back to young people who really need to know, and they're getting, you know, the insight from one as yourself who's so qualified?
Thank you. I love it. I love the students there are there for a particular reason. I mean, they're graduate students, and this is what they want to do. And so it's very rewarding, and they take obviously great interest in learning the craft and whatever I can help out with. They have other professors there as well who are incredibly talented and knowledgeable. So it's a very well-rounded program, and I look forward to it. I do twice a year, once each semester. The first semester I do my take on producing, because other producers and other professors have different takes on how they like to produce. And the second semester, I have the students apply what they learned the first semester and record chamber music, do chamber music recordings with either students or professional artists that they put together. And I supervise that, and I hover over them, and I tell them, look, this is not, I'm not going to grade you on how well you do, as long as this is a learning experience. And some students are more into classical than others. They all want to go into recording, but some are more into pop music, some are more into, but this is particularly with a classical music program, the program that I teach. It's very rewarding. Yeah.
Wow, this is fantastic. So you spent most of your working life at Columbia, and you've seen a lot of changes in classical music and, of course, in studios. And, you know, we're watching great places like Steinway Hall be reduced to rubble so apartment buildings can be built. I mean, it's such a pity. You know, you and I feel that we've seen the golden age, so to speak.
That's exactly right. That's exactly how I tell my friends and acquaintances. I say, you know, I wouldn't mind being a little younger, you know, but at least I've had the opportunity to come in at the tail end, I think, of the golden age of classical recording. And so I'm so lucky in that regard. What was I going to say? One thing I was going to mention, this is related to your earlier question about education, what really reinforced my interest in recording at college was working at the radio station. Uh-huh. My music education was just fine, but applying my interest to doing recordings out on Long Island, which is where Hofstra is, for chamber groups, taking the radio stations. It was a wonderful radio station, an FM station, and still is a wonderful station. Taking their equipment and going out on the island, looking in the New York Times to see what concerts are taking place on Long Island on the Sunday Times back then. Mm-hmm. And going out and saying, look, if you allow me to record your group, I will, you know, broadcast it over FM radio, over our college station. So that's really how I applied and learned my craft. Yeah. So the music education was great, but this was really
The hands-on.
I wanted to do hands-on, totally. And I'm trying to remember your last question. Forgive me.
Because I've got to say at this point, my recording engineer, Bob Small at WGCH Radio, where I broadcast from, is going to love you for those remarks. You know, radio is still important. And I feel it's making a comeback. I mean, I'm thrilled about it. But there is a personal touch. We talk about this constantly at our radio station, that it's a nice community. You know, it's a family, so to speak.
It is. I love radio. I've always loved radio. And but you know what? Back to your more recent question, your last question about how things have changed. And it's funny. It's sort of a paradox because it's changed for the better in the sense that there's so much more music available online for people to hear, for people to learn. You know, but on the other hand, and there's still a reasonable amount of recording, but pretty much I find anyone who has a computer and a couple of microphones can be a producer and an engineer.
That's right.
And it's not quite as it was with a more formal education and a more formal in recording, in the recording art. You mentioned about, well, for instance, studios, 30th Street Studio, the Columbia Studio. When I first walked in there, just having been hired by Columbia Records, and attending a recording session, you walk in there and there was this unbelievable vibe. It was this old church built in 1875. It was on 30th Street between 2nd and 3rd Avenues in New York City. And there was just this musty, wonderful sense of antiquity. You know, it's Stravinsky and Miles Davis and all the great recordings, jazz, classical, were done there, Horowitz. And in 1982, it was torn down. Columbia Records, CBS sold it, torn down, and now it's a medium-rise apartment building. And the greatest recordings were made there. Very, very sad. After that, I started doing some recording at RCA Studios, which was on 44th Street between 6th and 7th Avenues. And they had a good studio. It wasn't as good as 30th Street, but it was a good studio. We did a lot of jazz recordings there, Broadway recordings there. And then that became an IRS office, believe it or not, years later. So that was finished. So finding a good place to record these days is much more difficult. When you're doing classical recording, the studio isn't necessarily where you want to be anyway. I mean, 30th Street Studio was a church, so it was had wonderful acoustics. But a typical pop studio is not where you want to do acoustic, classical, chamber recording, or whatever. So there are places that I record now, and with COVID, of course, these places have closed up for temporarily, hopefully. Colleges such as Purchase College has a wonderful, two wonderful rooms, concert halls, a recital hall and a concert hall, very good acoustics. Recording Mechanics Hall, I don't know if you've heard of Mechanics Hall in Worcester, Massachusetts, which was built in 1857. It's gorgeous, gorgeous acoustics. So conducive to making great music. So it's not as easy these days to find a place to record. I mean, you can certainly do Broadway shows in studios, in pop studios. There's a wonderful pop studio. Wouldn't even call it a pop studio, but in New York, on 53rd Street, it used to be the power station. Now Berkeley School purchased it and they're keeping it active. It's wonderful.
Oh, that's great.
Great pop studios or great recording studios in the world these days.
Oh my gosh. Okay, when are you writing your book about all your experience, all the adventures? I mean, to memorialize all of these studios that have gone, you know?
I have an icon on my desktop saying book and I add things as I recall. And one of these days I would like to, because I mean, for me, growing up in Queens, you know, with my ear to my Admiral monophonic stereo, not stereo, monophonic television, radio, phonograph console, from those days, idolizing Isaac Stern in his recordings to getting a stereo console and then, you know, whatever, as time went on. Then to think that I would be working with the man I idolized, with Isaac Stern. I worked with him for about 20 years. Again, another dream come true, to have a collegial, you know, relationship with my idol. I mean, it was unbelievable. And to be able to tell him, well, Isaac, maybe a little bit flat on that G. Maybe. who would have thunk it?
Who would have thunk it? And you had that relationship. You earned it, baby. That's so wonderful.
Oh, it was
so
great.
Wonderful.
And then in the control room, he'd look at me and I'd look at him and he'd give me this knowing look. And then he'd remove a cigar from his pocket because I love cigars. He smoked all the time. And poor Yo-Yo. I remember we were doing a chamber recording with Manny, Yo-Yo, Jamie Laredo, and Isaac. And no problem smoking in the control room. But as soon as it started to smoke up, all those poor other artists just left the room. They couldn't stand. They couldn't take it. So, but it was Isaac Stern. So, you know.
Exactly. How wonderful for you. Steve, is there any part of you that looks back to the era of LPs and wish we could go backwards in a way out of a digital world?
You know, when digital was first introduced, it was only a two-track stereo. So everybody who was doing multi-track, I mentioned that I do two microphone orchestra recording when I can, but I'm not going to not put out a whole bunch of other microphones and feed them to other tracks. Just in case, you never know. There's so much money that, you know, the cost of doing an orchestra recording, you're not going to be foolish and not put out other microphones. But we hone and refine our technique to use as few microphones as possible. And I've done, as I say, so many recordings with only two mics. But digital recording initially was only two tracks. You could have a million microphones, but they'd be fed to two tracks.
Right.
You would have to lock into your balance right at the session. And a lot of producers and engineers were not used to doing that at that point. And so digital plus digital initially had a lot of problems with respect to just sound reproduction and recording. It was not perfect sound forever, as Sony had said initially. Mm-hmm. But eventually, all of those technical problems were overcome to a point where Sony and Philips introduced a Super Audio CD, SACD. To me, to this day, that is still the best method of capturing audio recordings. Unfortunately, it's not supported by as many companies now, as I mentioned, unfortunately. But to answer your question about LPs, I love LPs. I do hark back to listening to I have a very good turntable. But digital recording now is just on the same level and perhaps more successful in a way in listening back to the quality of recordings. I remember, perfect case in point, I did a recording a couple of years ago, Hello Dolly, with Bette Midler.
Yes.
And that came out on LP as well as CD. So I was tasked to listen to the test pressing for the LP. And I compared it to the test pressing of the CD, going back and forth, and it was virtually the same. I mean,
really?
You could practically not hear the difference in the sound quality to do that kind of critical listening back and forth. So my only wish perhaps is that if I were born a couple of years earlier, I might have been working with the likes of a George Sell or a Bruno Walter or a Stravinsky.
Yeah.
But I showed up a little bit later on the scene, and that's fine with me. I'm so fortunate to have worked with and working with the greatest artists, cream of the crop.
But it sounds to me that you've been as malleable as you could be through the decades. I mean, and certainly into the 70s, when you were really involved with Yo-Yo Ma, I believe. I read somewhere that you really referred to that as the end of the golden age, so to speak, of recordings.
Yeah, the tail end, that's what I say. I feel like I was lucky enough to get in on the golden age, the end of the golden age of recording, the tail end of that. We say 70s. I guess that's for me. I mean, that's my own opinion. Of course, other people might totally disagree with that.
Right.
I mean, I'm still recording Yo-Yo Ma. You know, how lucky is that? You know, still being able to do other recordings of classic Broadway shows, Carousel. I mean, it doesn't get better than that. But I guess when I say tail end of the golden age, we're talking so much classical because it's When I first started, Columbia Masterworks had the Philadelphia Orchestra, the New York Philharmonic, and the Cleveland Orchestra under exclusive contract. Can you imagine that nowadays?
No.
You know, so RCA had bought the Boston Symphony, you know, DG had their orchestras. Mm-hmm. And Columbia Masterworks had four or five producers on staff, including me at the time. Now there are no producers on staff of most labels, pretty much, most of the great labels.
It sounds like Hollywood, you know? I mean, you know, incredible. You know, I want to come back to Yo-Yo Ma and your work with this great cellist and the Silk Road Project. Was this something that you, as a producer, had envisioned? Was this your idea?
Oh, no. This totally Yo-Yo. Yo-Yo is so enterprising. He comes up with these very interesting ideas. He put that all together, got all the musicians together from all over the world, pretty much. So many Middle Eastern artists and composers that he incorporated into this project. That's pretty much his doing. I was very lucky to do, I did the first two albums of those very proud of them. He's so eclectic, you know, that's the thing. I mean, we do a Brazil album, we do a Dvorak cello concerto, then we do-
Ennio Morricone.
Morricone, exactly. Yes, that was
one of my favorite recordings to this day. I don't leave home without it, I tell you. I love the composer and I love what you did with that concept. It was fantastic. The cello could sing. In the hands of Yo-Yo Ma, most definitely.
Meeting Morricone for me was like, again, another, we had dinner with him one night. I remember all of us, it was just incredible. And I just love his music. It's just music. It just touches the soul. I mean, Cinema Paradiso. I mean, it's very difficult to watch that movie without tears streaming down your eyes.
Absolutely. There's no question about it. I've actually done two shows on Ennio Morricone himself. I have never talked to the man.
Oh, wow.
I've had so much fun exploring his music and way beyond just what's been popular in the American market. But his ability to really write the most beautiful melody that stays with you forever is extraordinary. And even in my angel choir, we have done a couple of his arrangements. I find his music to be
As vocalese kind
yes.
of writing.
Yes, yes. And some with words, you know. It, but there's just some otherworldly minimalism about his music that has staying power.
I totally agree with you. It just, did you know he was a trumpet player? That was his main instrument?
And it's so incredible to me when you consider the orchestration. I mean, you know, using a banjo, a jew harp, electric guitar. I mean, the many varied aspects of percussion that he used. It was not your norm, but yet what he conjured up orchestrally was really quite something.
It was so natural. In other words, it couldn't have been any other way, his orchestrations. And
if I had been at that dinner, I probably wouldn't have been able to speak. I would have just been a fangirl.
No, his presence could be intimidating, but he was a nice man. You know, the little couple of days that I had the chance to work with him.
So tell me, with all these Grammys to your name, all of your awards, which are many, your gold records, tell me, what is the Grammy experience like? I mean, this is for we mere mortals who haven't had that experience, Steven Epstein.
Well, it's otherworldly. I mean, when you find out you're nominated, that's great. Really the highlight, unless you win, of course. And then if you attend the festivities, which I've done several times, it is incredibly stressful because you're nervous about winning and going up and accepting the award, and you're also nervous about losing.
Exactly.
it's not fun, the actual occasion. Oh. But on the occasion when you do win, it's nothing like it in the world. It's just such a wonderful experience. And I'm very lucky. I mean, I'm very lucky, you know. I mean, working with the great artists that I work with, you know, to have that kind of,
legacy.
What was that? Legacy, exactly. Thank you. Yes.
I mean, and you're the hot ticket then. You can't fail after that. And you've been so visible. You know, I think it's so interesting how as a youth, you're looking at the back of album covers. And here now, whenever I turn something over and see your name, I just smile to myself. And I think, you know, I had the opportunity to interview the great British pianist, Paul Lewis. Told a very similar story to yours in that as a youth, he grew up in North England. And his public library was a inner sanctum for him. And he used to go to the library and listen to classical music. And he listened to the great pianists. And of course, he started to teach himself, started to have piano lessons, and the rest is history. It's so incredible when you think about the formation of all of us as young people, when we're so open, when we're so hungry and ripe.
You know, for me, it's a hobby as much as it is and a love, you know, and I'm just to be able to express myself, you know, with holding a CD in hand, you know, that I produced. I mean, there's nothing like that. And, you know, you mentioned, you know, what artists I'm perhaps working with and have worked with. The one very promising and encouraging thing is some of, as you're saying, some of the younger artists. Mm-hmm. And I just recently worked with Reed Tetzlaff. Wonderful fine pianist, which gives one hope. I mean, not that I haven't lost hope, but he is such a fine pianist, and we did a recording of music of Charles Ives coupled with Beethoven, which might seem like an unusual coupling, the Ives Concord Sonata and Beethoven Opus 110. Throughout the Ives Concord Sonata, there's quotations in every movement of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. So there's definitely a correlation there. It was just, you know, he's one of the fine young artists that I have an opportunity to continue this evolution, you know, of making records.
We at Center Stage know Reed Tetzlaff very well. And I've actually asked, when I finally leave this earth, I want Reed Tetzlaff to be playing for my memorial. There's something about Reed that is hypersensitive. There is a world he goes to, and he takes us with him when he plays.
No question. I, you know, I studied the Ives Concord is a very difficult piece of music to comprehend. And once you understand it, it's just ingenious, brilliant, and very, very moving, I find.
Yeah.
And I listen to a lot of recordings and then get to the session, get to Massachusetts where we recorded this in Rockport, Massachusetts, and hear him play this for the first time. And I say, you know what? This is the first time that in one performance, this really makes sense right from the start. You know, you have such an incredible grasp of this piece of music. And he does. And just like you're saying, something very, very special. And the Beethoven, you know, equally so. Incredibly satisfying and very moving performances of both pieces. So that's great to hear you say what you're saying about, hopefully he'll be playing for you before what you just mentioned.
I hope so too. I think Reed is an old soul, and I know whenever he speaks about his music, again, you just feel that you're in the presence of someone very special. So I'm thrilled you're hooked up with him.
Me too.
How exciting. And I believe there's film coverage of Reed right now. We're really earmarking him as one of the artists to watch for the future. And I'm so excited you're involved with him. That's fantastic.
Yeah, me too. Yeah.
So, Steve, you worked for Columbia Records for over 30 years.
And 33 then years.
33 years, yeah. And then you were at Sony BMG Masterworks. You eventually became a senior executive at Sony Classical. Did you ever consider starting your own record label?
It's funny you should mention that. After I left Sony, I actually thought, you know what? There are other companies that might be interested in starting a label, big companies. I wasn't gonna do it on my own. I mean, producing records is enough of a task, you know, enough of a time consuming endeavor for me. I contacted a couple of companies and for whatever reasons, again, economy and the way the business is going, they declined. I got pretty close to one big company actually starting a label. I was thinking a jazz label and a classical label that I would, you know, perhaps oversee or, you know, have something to do with. But, you know, my main interest isn't getting my hands dirty and just sitting at the, you know, learning a piece of music and working with an artist and sitting at the control desk and doing that kind of work. That's really my main interest, not in administrating or anything like that.
Yeah. Well, I understand what a headache that would be, but what a good idea. And you would be the perfect person to put their mark on a new record label. That'd be exciting.
Thank you.
Good Lord. Are you, I mean, you're obviously a problem solver, but do you think you live a passionate life, Steve?
Oh yeah. I mean, that can be defined in many ways, you know. I mean, you know, it's funny when I hear people saying, I love classical music, it's so relaxing, you know, and I say, oh, yeah, okay, right. well, sure. I mean, Brahms lullaby is relaxing. But you listen to, you know, a Beethoven symphony or God knows what else, you know, a contemporary masterpiece or no, it's not relaxing. If you're really listening and getting involved, it can be incredibly passionate and incredibly involving.
Yeah.
So I sort of feel sorry for the people who just, you know, like, well, I can, you know, I have insomnia, so I put on some classical music and it puts me to sleep, you know. And there are people who, you know, when I tell them what I do, say, oh, I love classical music for that reason. So yeah, I guess passion is part of, you know, my makeup is, you know, regarding loving and listening and not performing. I mean, I studied violin, and for the benefit of the music world, I gave it up like quite a few years ago. but you know, it was great learning the instrument, of course.
But you're now happily married to a wonderful pianist.
Yeah, so that's the other definition of passionate.
There you go.
It's, you know, it's wonderful. You know, it's amazing. I remember when I first met my wife, we met at a Seder, and I wasn't expecting her to be here. I didn't know who she was. It was actually a Seder someone else had invited me. when she was also invited. And then it was pretty much love at first sight. And I remember it was in Atlantic City, where she's from. And we took a walk on the boardwalk. It was at night. We left together. And I told her what I recently had recorded. And it was Schumann's Piano Quartet with Isaac Stern, Yo-Yo, Jamie Laredo, and Emmanuel Axe. And she started singing the second movement to me, which is one of the most beautiful movements ever written of anything. And I said, whoa, this is someone to contend with. This is somebody I have to know. I have to know better.
Propose then, right?
Can you imagine? Practically, yes. Yeah, so, you know, nothing like having a mutual passion, mutual interest, you know.
Oh, yeah, to sustain each other through life, absolutely, and to become best friends. I love that.
Yeah.
I love that. Yeah. Can I ask you about getting back to recording again? I want to talk about live performances, recording live performances. I mean, first of all, I know they're difficult, but is there anything really authentic about a live performance, or is it just a composite of many different performances kind of put together?
Preaching to the choir.
Yep.
When I do my course at McGill, I do a section of it on live versus studio recording. And the first thing I tell them, I say, I have to tell you, first of all, live recording isn't really live in the sense that if you're doing a live recording in a concert situation of a symphony, it's going to be maybe three or four performances that are stitched together to the best moments for editing purposes. Well, already that's not spontaneous planning. I mean, that's 24 hours at least apart from, you know, take one to take two, so to speak, as opposed to doing a recording in a studio with probably better acoustics, or in a concert hall without an audience, let's put it that way.
Right.
Better acoustics and a more contiguous performance. In other words, take one, take two, take three. The mindset is already there. If it's a good conductor, it's going to be just as exciting. You know, I hear people say, well, you know, live performances are much more exciting than studio performances. That's not true. Sometimes it is, but not as a rule. Right. That's one situation. The acoustics are usually never as good. So the sound quality, the hearing a piece of music emerge from a velvety dark background, no, you're always going to hear some rustling or something going on, which you're going to try. Actually, when you do a patch session, that's the other thing. You may be doing three or four live concerts patched together, but then you'll do a two-hour patch session without an audience, so you can fix things that still are problematic. So it's really a hodgepodge. If it's a great orchestra, really good orchestra, good conductor, whatever, it's going to be very satisfying. And but for instance, like if you're doing a violin piano recital live, it could be wonderful, no question, if the artists are great. Excuse me, but that violinist is playing for the last row in Carnegie Hall, and the microphones are not in the last row; they're close to get a good sound, proper sound. Not too close, of course, but at the right, normal, right position. And,
correct.
You know, so that violinist is going to be projecting and playing out much more forcefully than, let's say, creating a certain nuance in a studio where that doesn't have to take place. Or in a situation, when I say studio, I mean a concert hall or a really good room. I don't mean a dead studio. So I am generally, whenever someone says, you know, we can do live recording, I'm usually saying, okay, great. You know, we'll make the best of it. And to tell you the truth, a little secret is that sometimes when I do a live recording and we have a patch session that's 2 hours, well, that piece of music is going to be so well rehearsed in those three preceding concerts that patch session is going to have a lot of very polished playing and still very great playing. And what I'll do is I'll listen, and acoustically it'll probably be better. Even though people will say, well, what about an empty concert hall? How does that match in a live concert hall with a whole bunch of people? Doesn't that change the acoustics if you're going from one to the other? To a point, it does. Cumulatively, it does.
Yes.
But if you're patching with little pieces, it doesn't make much of a difference at all. Nevertheless, during a patch session, I try to capture as much as I can of a performance and use most of that, if it's as good and as exciting, quote unquote, as a live recording. This is going to sound better and it's going to be just great. Yeah.
A lot of elements going into this.
Yeah. Sorry for that long explanation.
No, it's great. No, this is fascinating. I need to ask you, as a singer myself, How difficult is it to record the human voice? I mean, I know voices have so many varying factors to them. Some have a soft edge, some have a hard core. You know, are there tricks to the trade and how to get the best vocal sound?
If you're in a good room, which is number one, mm-hmm. There isn't any more difficulty in recording a voice, I find, than I find violin and piano for some reason most difficult to record.
Really? Yeah.
Voice, I don't find difficult to record. I'm trying to think. I mean, sometimes we'll, depending on, you see, this is the thing. If the vocalist or the soloist will want to see the keyboard if they're doing a recital, right. You know, so they can be together. And as a recording producer and an engineer, you want that soloist to appear in the center of the loudspeakers, not off to the side when you're listening. It's not satisfying. And the energy is all over to one side. So the artist then says, well, I can't see the piano. I can't see the keyboard. So there are several ways to attack that.
Right.
Basically to sweet talk the artist as best you can, to moving a little bit more to the crook of the piano, or sometimes to have the artist face the piano. In the center, but can see the gesture of the pianist and can be close enough to stay together. Of course, if you're doing that, then the singer is singing into the back of the hall, not into the rear of the stage, mm-hmm. and the acoustics may not take full advantage right. of the voice of the singer or the violinist or whoever else. So you have to weigh all these possibilities, all these differences, but I don't find really much of a challenge in that regard mm-hmm. over mm-hmm. a voice over another instrument, except maybe, as I say, violin and piano. Cello and piano is much easier. Go figure.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
Wow, yeah. Wow. Yeah, because we have to have that conjugation, that ability in sight to, you know, for the performers to see each other, to connect. And it is difficult sometimes in the setup. That's interesting.
What's again, the approach that I like to take is with as few microphones as possible. So mm-hmm. in a vocal recital recording, we put up two omnidirectional microphones that pick everything up and get the best sound on the piano because that's the anchor. And then move the vocalist, or if it's a violinist, whatever, more or less to and fro to get the optimum focus over those main microphones, getting the body of sound. Then using a spot mic to define the sound of the vocalist ever so slightly. Maybe it's not even necessary. It probably is necessary. But again, the body of sound gets picked up overall by these main microphones, still keeping the sense of intimacy or whatever is required in the recording. But there are so many ways, you know, to, and the thing is, it's never the same. That's the wonderful thing about this business. Yeah. You know, you can go and put measurements, do all of this and that, but if the humidity is different and the temperature is a little bit different. All these factors come into play mm-hmm. with where you put your microphones and mm-hmm. it's never set and forget.
And the mood of the performers. Oh boy.
That's probably the main thing. That's true. I left that one out. That's true.
I'll bet you become quite the diplomat over the years. My gosh.
You have to be a chameleon. You know, you have to work with the temperament of the artist that you're working with and not be too much of a wise guy, you know, and be very respectful, yeah. Very assured in what you're doing. And if an artist says to me as a producer, did I cover that note? And I'm not sure. I say, you know what? I'm really not sure. Let's have it again. Mm-hmm. If you say you're not sure, you know, several times, then that's not good either. But you have to be honest. You have to be honest with the artist, and they have to trust you to realize that you're listening very carefully.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I suppose that same way when you work with the pop artists and the jazz artists, Wynton Marsalis, Bobby McFerrin. I mean, golly, this is a completely different kettle of fish, or is it?
That's a very good point. Not really. You know, I mean, you know, you could. As long as you have good musical sensibilities, whatever exactly that is, but as long as you have a good musical sense, you know, I think there is a difference recording a Broadway show than recording an opera. I mean, in a Broadway show, you're going to want a greater deal of intimacy. You're going to have do it in a pop type studio with gobos, you know, with the isolation between whatever, but you're still going to want to get a really good vocal sound, not a close and dry sound. You're going to want to make it have all the qualities that represent that artist. But in an opera, your microphones are going to be farther away. It's going to be a symphony orchestra. You're not going to be isolating the singers. Mm-hmm. And their main, again, the main body of the sound of it in an opera of the singers is going to be over the main microphones, defining each singer with their own spot microphones. But in a Broadway show, there's no defining. The spot microphones are the main microphones. So you have to be very careful as to what your choice in microphones are in either case.
Right, right. Yeah. Very interesting. Very interesting. Steve, what a life you've had. My gosh. And it continues. You're out there freelancing now?
No.
Are you ever going to slow down, do you think?
That's a very good question. Probably, you know, I don't want to take on too much, but I you know, love making records and the technique of it all and how the technique has changed. I mean, in 1973 or 74, when you're talking about, you know, 200,000, well, let's say when digital first came out with their multi-track machines, $200,000 machines, and now you're talking about, you know, $1,500 computer and associated software and hardware, you know, where you can make recordings that sound maybe better, at least from the standpoint specifications, electronic specifications.
Yeah.
Who would have thought, you know, so I can easily go and engineer and record something on my own if it's not going to be, you know, anything beyond a certain amount of players.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. You are the expert. You are the legend. Let's face it. Your Grammy wins are right up there with the best in the business. This is quite something, Steve. So thanks, let me ask something really, really simple. What do you do in your downtime? What do you do for fun? And it's not fair to say that you're going to go build a Heath kit or you're going to go back to radio, okay?
Well, I'm speechless. We live up here in Dutchess County, very rural part of Dutchess County, up north. We also have a place in Manhattan. We just built a small barn where I'm going to build Heathkits. Not Heathkits, but where I'm hoping to build. I built a Zuckerman clavichord years ago. I'm hoping to maybe build another, maybe a virginal or one, you know, a instrument. And now that my wife plays keyboard, I can actually have somebody play on it. To build four, exactly. You know, I love movies, home theater, you know, that kind of thing.
Oh, yeah, me too.
Do you?
Oh, I am the ultimate film girl. If I had to do it all over again, I'd go back to USC and do film school. I'm telling you right now,
Is that right?
I would. I'm passionate about film. I'm really passionate about film music. I do believe that it takes its place well within classical music at this stage of the game, because I do feel that classical music is changing, as corny as that sounds, to a certain degree. And I think that there are some film composers. We mentioned Ennio Morricone, of course, the great John Williams. When I look back to people like Bernard Herrmann, I become very excited. The quality of the music. I mean, if you look at Bernard Herrmann, he wrote an opera. Several of the themes were actually used in The Ghost and Mrs. Muir. I feel that this music, the music of Korngold, I think it is just as important as anything that has been turned out by certainly any contemporary classical composer. So, I'm in love.
I agree.
I totally know this.
I mean, consider, I mean, and Vaughan Williams and Shostakovich and Prokofiev also wrote for film, very, very true. Did you like older films?
Yes, I'm a classic film nut. I've been out to Los Angeles for the Turner Classic Movie Film
Oh, have you?
Festival.
Oh, terrific.
I mean, I'm very much into that. But as a young girl growing up in Oregon in a small town, that was my way into the entertainment world. I was isolated. I didn't have classical music around me, and so it was really the classic films that it really lured me into the visual, the art of cinematography, and the marriage of music and the visual, which to this day I'm still fascinated in.
Oh, that's wonderful. And you
It's
can.
interesting. I did a wonderful interview with the composer Stefan Machio, who is a fantastic songwriter. He's written for Celine Dion and many others. And he and I had a kind of marriage of the minds over the film score of Meet Joe Black. And we just talked about just the orchestration, the arrangement, the whether or not actually the music was better than the film. And of course,
Interesting.
when you look at Hitchcock films, you have to ask the same question, because really Bernard Herrmann or Hitchcock's choices of composers were always fantastic and equaled. When John Williams and Steven Spielberg, I mean, the marriage made in heaven, one complements the other equally.
Isn't that interesting? Yeah, I mean that's a special talent by the director, to have
Oh,
the,
yeah.
I didn't mention Wynton Marsalis. I mean, I actually did the soundtrack of a film of his quite a while ago, but he's done a couple of film scores and documentary scores. Some wonderful, some one. I mean, I would love to see him do more composing. I mean, I
Yeah.
love his writing.
Yeah, he's a very special artist. There's no,
Very special,
I
very
always
special.
get the impression with him that he's an ambassador. That he's a very strong leader in the world of music in
Oh,
a
he
very
is definitely.
subtle way. It's interesting to me.
Yeah.
That's so great. That's so
So.
great. You've worked with him. Oh my gosh. I could go on here forever. I mean, I'm sure we could speak for another 2 hours.
I'm sure.
But your life in this world of record production, living your bliss, as Joseph Campbell, one of my personal gods, says, you, Steven Epstein, have lived your bliss, and you still are. What do you see in the future now for other young artists like Reed Tetzloff that we mentioned, and more projects on the back burner?
Yeah, definitely. It's wonderful. We're doing the complete Beethoven trios. Not only doing complete Beethoven piano trios with Yo-Yo, Emmanuel Ax, and Leonidas Kavakos. In fact, the first iteration of that series will be out in a couple of weeks. Beethoven's Second Symphony,
Exciting.
which I believe Ferdinand Ries, Beethoven's student, arranged that for trio, and an arrangement of his Fifth Symphony, a contemporary arrangement. It's very good.
Oh, wow.
So that's so now Yo-Yo is very excited, as the rest of them are, about having more arrangements for piano trio to interest more chamber musicians and more people, just in classical music in general. These great symphonies put in this chamber music format. So we're going to be continuing that, as well as the trios that Beethoven wrote for piano trio
Oh.
specifically. So it's a very extensive ongoing project, which I'm very excited about. The players, just
Oh,
incredible music
wow.
making. So that's an ongoing project. I just did done some recording with the Stoltzmans, with Richard and Mika Stoltzman. Richard being the great clarinetist and Mika being a great marimba player.
Interesting.
Music arranged for them, and solo clarinet, solo marimba, it's Bach. And we just finished an album that, or two albums actually, that should be out in the not too distant future. So yeah, there are a lot of things keeping life interesting, and then having some time to enjoy movies and other things.
Absolutely. So let me ask you this, getting back to your barn that you've built, which I'm kind of harboring this idea that, you should have concerts going on, or maybe just film nights, or both. I mean, how wonderful.
Well, it's too small. I mean, it really is a small barn for well, we could have music night there, I guess.
You bet you could.
But we have like a home theater in the basement here, And the wonderful thing, I know you would appreciate this, having seeing these old films from the even the 30s, 40s, 50s that have been redone for digital, for high definition, for 4K, yes. UHD, to seeing them on a big screen, better than in the original theatrical, showing. It's just great what's being done to these old films, and how they're being preserved.
Exciting. Exciting. Oh, my God. We are on the same wavelength there for sure, Steven Epstein. As I was just watching Casablanca the other night. And, of course, we're getting this reissue of The Godfather quite soon.
So I know.
This is really exciting.
I think I'll miss Godfather Part 3, frankly.
Yeah, I think.
One and two are two of the greatest masterpieces of filmography that I've ever seen.
Oh, unbelievable. And I'm enjoying so much all the interviews right now with Francis Ford Coppola about this and looking back at it. And really, the complexities of making one and two, I mean, incredible. When he had nothing, when he was poor, he hadn't proved to Hollywood yet. So it's, and talk about family.
He went to Hofstra University, as I did.
Did he really?
Francis Ford Coppola. And in fact, the famous scene where James Caan gets machine gunned at the toll booths in the first, that was apparently shot on the parking lot of Hofstra, where they set up some toll booths and filmed it there. It was supposed to be the Southern State Parkway on Long Island. But this is what, you could look it up. This is where they
came. How exciting.
That's something. A little film trivia.
I love that. I absolutely adore that.
Yeah.
And Stephen, I've adored this entire interview. This has been, wow. Talk about coming full circle again. That's the theme of this interview, isn't it? It's like a Schumann song cycle. Yeah. We've started out with a theme and we're ending with the same theme, you and I. And it's so exciting to hear about your work. I've got one really important question for you right now.
Sure.
If there is any word or phrase that describes really who you are, that really defines who you are. Because I love for my listeners to really know the heart and soul of my guests. If you can think of anything that really sums you up, what would that be?
Huh. Well, let's see. Passionate perfectionist, I don't know.
I love that.
and realist.
Yeah. If you're a realist, then the passionate perfection can have some wiggle room for a little imperfection that makes things special.
That's very good. That's true.
And
thank
I'm sure
you.
I'm sure that's a big element in your music making and what you've done over the years with all these fantastic artists, all these well-deserved Grammys and awards. My gosh. I feel like I should be bowing at your feet. It's such an honor to have you on my show.
Pam, you're the best. And I'm telling you, it's so great to reconnect with you. And I really enjoyed this immensely. This
interview. I'm so
just speaking with you beyond anything else, even, so.
That's the best compliment I can have. You've made my week.
Well.
All right, Steven Epstein, you keep doing what you've doing and you have been doing. And by all means, keep that journey of resolve in making sound beautiful at the highest level. And we will look at the back of every CD and check out all the information to see your name, Steven Epstein, and celebrate it. And thank you so much. All right.
Thank you so much.
Stay well and all the best.
Well,
everyone listening, you can find this Zoom interview, this entire Zoom interview on my website, centerstagewithpamelacoon.com. Please go out and discover Steven Epstein. It won't be difficult. I can tell you that right now. And please also go to my website to see a gallery of some of my shows. And I hope you'll tune in at WGCH Talk Radio in Greenwich, Connecticut, where my shows are featured every Tuesday at 9:02 a.m. In the meantime, thank you, Steven Epstein. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Pam.
And to everyone out there, stay safe, everyone. This is Pamela Kuhn, and the curtain is now down on Center Stage. Thank you.